So let's go.
Back again to teach you another painting. This time, instead of using a canvas, we are going to use a pumpkin as our canvas. And I'm going to teach you a couple different paintings at one time. I'm going to alternate between the two. That allows for some drying time, and it also allows for fun couple paintings. I have been painting pumpkins to put on my porch for about 10 years now. They are perfectly fine out in the weather. I'm in Oregon, it rains a lot, and they last really great. And rather than carving, which they tend to rot really fast with carving, but the painted pumpkins you can keep up till Thanksgiving if you want. So I have made a fairly simple and neutral palette with a couple pops of color. I have a bright yellow, bright orange, white and black. And then I have burnt sienna and raw sienna. And those should get me through both paintings. We'll see. I have some other paint set aside just in case I need it. But I'm going to go ahead and get started. So I have three brushes. I have a 1-inch wide brush that seems to be the good one to start most paintings with. And then I have a number 8 bright and a number 4 round. Now these three brushes we sell on the GoBox website for $12 for the bundle. And then my palette is just a simple 50 sheet wax paper palette that we also sell for $6. So you can get those anytime, or you can use a paper plate that works just fine. So I'm gonna start with my 1-inch brush. I always like to dip it in the water first and then blot it on the towel so that it's just a little bit damp. Kind of seems to loosen up the bristles and make it a little more flexible. And to start, I'm going to actually paint a big yellowish moon. And I think I'm actually going to mix a little white and yellow together. And I tend to not overmix. I actually kind of like a blotchy mix most of the time, because then you get these nice color streaks naturally in here. And on the pumpkin, usually what I'll do is I'll set it up and I'll look for the side that's going to be up most, so that when it's on the porch, it's low down. And that way people walking up to your door can actually see the painting without it being tilted too far down. This one has a nice flat spot on the back, so that works great for sitting it on here for painting. So to start, I'm just gonna sketch out a circular shape, and it doesn't have to be a perfect circle. How are we doing, Paul?
Looking pretty good.
This is like take 100, but we managed. We managed to get it done. We've got our new computer working over there. And now our document camera is giving us a little bit of grief tonight, but we'll get through it. So yeah, I'm just sort of dabbing this paint on here. The moon, when you look at it, has a lot of craters. And you get those in a painting by leaving some spots more shaded and other spots with a more opaque coating of paint. Am I not talking loud enough? Is that what the problem is?
No, you need to move the pumpkin up.
I need to move the pumpkin this way?
Yeah.
Okay, how's that?
That's getting a little bit too far.
All right. Well, hopefully you all can see it okay. So the paint is actually drying really fast on this, which is kind of a surprise. Because there's nothing really to absorb it, like canvas. But we have a little fan going in the room because it's scorching hot in here because of all the lights we have on. So we were dying for a little while. I think I've got a nice sheen going on. All right, so let me just stand up and take a peek. Circular-ish, that's all I'm looking for. And that's a good size. What I want to do now is I'm going to mix a little black into my yellow mixture. So I'm sort of graduating away from the light color of the moon. So you're going to end up with sort of a light gray. I'm just going to circle the moon with this. Let them mix together. The edges of this moon should actually end up being pretty faded out. Not a real sharp edge. Ooh, yeah, it got really dark right away. I will probably go back and add another coat of paint to the moon in a while once it's really dry. I'm gonna add a little more black to my mix. Getting darker and darker. And I'm using pretty long brush strokes here when I can, especially along the sides here, where you've got the pumpkin that goes down and around. It works really good. This is where I kind of wish I was left-handed for this side, or ambidextrous. So if you want to and you have the time, you could actually paint the whole rest of this pumpkin the dark color, so you don't have any orange left at all. I'm just gonna sort of do a painting on the face of this. Gradually adding a little more black in here. If you do end up painting the whole pumpkin with the dark charcoal gray, it looks really good to paint the stem the dark color as well. Or you can leave it natural. But I thought of that as an idea. Painting the stem would be pretty cool. And you could even cover it with a coat of Mod Podge and black glitter. That's always really fun. We like using glitter in the studio when we can. It's just kind of a pain to clean up. All right. So I've got pretty much what I'm going to do with the dark part. A couple spots I could probably blend in a little better. But the moon is left sort of raggedy around the edges now, so I'm going to work on fading that in. What I want to do is wash my brush really good and get most of that dark, if you can get all of the dark paint off of it, that would be great. What I do is I tend to just jab it on the bottom of the cup lightly, and that will knock off some excess paint pigment. And then I'm going to dry it off really well. And it looks like I'm going to have to remix my white and yellow. Got polluted with a little black. So this is a great time to put a second coat on. There's some spots I can see where it's still a little bit wet, but it's going to work just fine. And as I get out towards the edges, what I like to do is just sort of let my brush run out of paint. So then you get this really cool, faded out, kind of foggy glow. How we looking, Paul?
Looks good.
Techie boy. Oh, what did I do up here? Okay. Pumpkins are interesting to paint on. Being so round and sitting down, I keep wanting to stand up.
The problem is when you stand up, you kind of are tending to put your head over the...
Okay. I will back away. So I'm going to get a little, I'm dipping the brush in just plain yellow now, and I can get some nice warm color in there. Just sort of dabbing it on. So I'm left with some darker patches with light thin paint, and then more opaque patches to give that kind of cratery look. You can do that with texture too. I'm using pretty thin acrylic paint here, so texture would be a process to build up. But this is what I've got right now, and I'm going to move this aside and let it dry, because I need the moon to dry before I start painting the haunted house and the ground and all that in there. So I'm going to move it aside real quick, and I'm using the same palette. Probably won't use yellow so much on this one. Bringing in my white pumpkin here. Let's have a look. We've got some pitted spots on the back. I guess there's... This is probably a good side. I have a tendency to want to just go right here where it sort of bumps up. That would make a nice spot for the beak of the bird to come down because they kind of poke out. So, my brush, I need to wash it off. I'm going to do that real quick. For the owl... I'm going to take a sip of wine. I've got rosé in here. My cup from Potter's Vineyard just down the street in Sherwood, kind of between Sherwood and Newburgh. Great, great spot. We teach some classes there. And It's called Potter's Vineyard because they are potters, and Paul and I were really attracted to this set here. We kind of feel like we're in a Game of Thrones when we drink out of these. I guess they're kind of rustic. So I'm going to start with my number 8 Bright. It's about a quarter inch wide, flat brush. Go ahead and dip it in the water, dry it off. And I'm going to actually start with, I'm going to mix a little white and raw sienna. What I'm aiming for is an off-white. Can you see that on my mixing there, Paul?
Yeah.
Okay. So we want an off-white because this will provide a nice base. And when we come back to paint the pure white feathers on the bird, they'll really show up because we've got the dark underneath. So I'm going to actually grab a little of this burnt sienna too. And even a touch of black. The dog butted in. Our dogs are really excited and curious as to what we're doing in this room. The only time we ever would spend time in this room is to run on the treadmill, which happens so little that the dogs are really shook when we go in here. So I've made this really not so attractive color. Actually, it's very, very similar to the color of the pumpkin. And normally I would use raw umber, but I happen to not have any here at home. So the owl face, barn owl, is shaped like, let me see, I've got a painting here with a partial face. Okay, so it's kind of a heart shape, actually, or like an apple, like if you were to slice an apple in half. So it's got the, sort of comes down to a point like a widow's peak in the front, and then a rounded chin. So, let's go ahead and do that. I'm just sketching the face, not any part of the head. So I'm starting like I'm drawing a heart. So right along here. And then I'll take a look and see, where do I want the chin to end? It's probably going to be right about here. And the chin can be slightly pointed, or it can be rounded. I've looked at a lot of barn owl pictures over the years, and then seen some in person too, which is really cool. And they do have slightly different face shapes. Some have more of a narrow sort of face, and then others it's really round, and some have a pointed chin, and others have a really round face and chin. I'm gonna wash this brush off. I need a bigger brush to cover the front here. So I'm gonna go back to my 1-inch brush. And I'm just gonna put on a thin coat of this really boring beige, which I never make enough, so I almost always have to make more, and then trying to match it is funny. But if I don't match it exact, I'll just kind of blend the two together. This will make a good undercoat for the owl. We do a class at Vingo that's called Paint Your Pet, and the customers sign up for the class, and then they're prompted to email a pet photo in. And we use a projector, and we sketch their pet onto canvas for them, so they're ready to roll once it comes in. Once they come in, and they'll find their canvas with the pencil sketches on there, and immediately recognize their pet. But we do get a lot of white dogs, and so we teach people to do a off-white or gray or light brown undercoat, and then paint the white fur on top, and it gives it some real depth. That looks really good. Otherwise, they just look like a big cotton ball. Okay, so now I'm going to wash this brush off, and I'm going to go to my number 8 again. I probably use the number 8 the most out of any brush in the studio ever. And I tend to like flat brushes because you can sort of manipulate them and turn them and get into lots of little crevices. And it's real easy to be pretty detailed with these. So I'm going to take my burnt sienna. And I'm going to mix a little raw sienna with it. So I'm going to get a color that would be, I don't know what you'd call this. Caramel, maybe?
I would say it's latte, no?
No, I've never... How about a latte? Look, it's terracotta. How about that? Terracotta.
I was looking at the middle color.
Oh, this one. Okay. Yeah, that's definitely latte. Okay, so now what I want to do is I want to make the top of the head, which is going to round above. I'm using the skinny edge of the brush to sketch it on. And then it's just going to go around the sides. They have pretty thick necks, actually. So once I get around the chin area, lined up here and here, I'm going to go out for the shoulders. We'll just kind of go off the bottom of the pumpkin. Looks really funny. It's like a mugshot, like an owl mugshot. So now I'm going to fill in the top of the head with this sort of rusty terracotta color. It's really weird painting on a ridge surface. And this color comes down along the sides, almost like sideburns. And then it just kind of fades out right as the neck curves into the chin. And this is actually part of their feathers. Their wings, I'm sorry, feather. Feather, wing, it's late. Okay, so now I'm gonna get this side too. Go down for the sort of sideburny look. Scoop it inward, and this guy is going to come down here. There you go. Definitely will need a second coat because it's very streaky and see-through. And like most paintings of things with faces, it starts out looking really ugly and you'll have a hard time trusting the process, but just trust the process. We'll all get to where we need to go. So let's see, I'm gonna clean up the top edge here just a little. And we're gonna let that dry for a bit. Actually, before we do let it dry, I wanna get the chest coated in that beigey color we made for the face, or something similar. It needs an undercoat too, because the chest is going to have white feathers, just like the face. So I make a similar color and just swipe it on there. It's okay if it blends with your reddish color here on the sides. That looks natural and nice. And now, Mr. Owl, you really don't look really good right now, and we are going to give you a rest. So we'll set you over here for drying. And back to the haunted house. I'm really liking the way this is looking. So far, so good. I'm going to take a little sip of my rosé here. And we're going to get ready to do some stars. So for stars, I like to use the handle end of my littlest brush. It works perfect. It works kind of like a rubber stamp. And what you're going to do is you're going to poke it in the white. And so that I don't get gigantic stars when I first start out, I'll usually poke it a couple times on my palette. And the stars are just going to go in the black area. And I like a lot of them. Even though technically you wouldn't really see this because the moon is going to put off so much light that the stars nearby would not be so visible. I tend to kind of skip around here and there. That helps me avoid painting a polka dot pattern. I don't know why I'm putting stars on the ground. We'll probably might edit that part out.
It's really easy to edit out.
Good. It's really late. I worked like 9 hours today, and I'm very tired. And then I sat here for like 2 hours while Paul tried to get the equipment all set up, and I'm sweating. All right, so back to stars. We do not need stars on the ground. Nicely edited. It's like they never were. I suppose if you were doing just a floating moon with no ground in sight, you could definitely put or is underneath. Knowledge. All right. Okay, nice little star setting there. Now, this isn't a super spooky haunted house. This is kind of more of a fun, like, I might walk by and take a picture, but I'm not going to go inside. So I'm going to paint the ground in now, which will be just, I'll hold this up for that camera. It's just going to go right along there. For those of you, for the zoom in part, let me scoot it up here. It's just going to go here. And I'm going to use my middle brush, which is the number 8 black paint. And I'm just going to come in. I'm going to create a nice little setting. My house needs to go into kind of a flat area, sort of. It can be really wonky, actually. I like to come up high over here because I put some gravestones that are sort of tilted. So that is little ground setting, and this is all going to be painted in with black, which I'll do with my big brush just to get it done quick. And this can just go right to the edge of your circle. Or if you want to paint all around it for fun, you could do a whole landscape all around the whole entire pumpkin. Painting is really good therapy. And so, you know, you could work on this for days. You could work on it one night and then decide, you know, the next night you need a little de-stressing too. So then you can work on the side of it. Then another night you work on the back. Or you could do it all at one time. Okay. So I'll just kind of clean up the edges a little bit here. Maybe I'll make this go up a little higher. Wipe out a few stars. All right. So what I'm going to put on my haunted house design is I'm going to have the house here. And it's going to be really wonky and tall and skinny, kind of Tim Burton-like. And then on the right side, I'm going to put a spooky tree. And then some gravestones coming out, crosses and little gravestones. And then probably some bats. So let's start with a very simple house. Everything okay? All right, everything's working. I think to start, I'll use the number 8 brush. You're more than welcome to use this number 4 if you feel like you need a smaller, pointier brush. I've gotten so used to this number 8 that I will use it all the time because I can use the skinny edge to sketch things on. Let me just take a look. Okay. So what I'm going to do first is I'm just going to make a couple lines that go up. Now, I was going to say straight lines, but don't make them straight. It can be a house that looks like it's about to fall over. And then I'll make like a tall peaked roof. So this is like the simple house that you probably learned to draw when you're in kindergarten. And we're going to change it up a bit from there. So let's see. Now I'm going to make a tall like spire thing. Maybe comes up the side here. And this could have one of those funky cupola things. My aunt and uncle used to have this really old house that had a cone-shaped cupola thing on the top, and it was so spooky, but very cool. Super antique. And let's see, so on this side, maybe I'll just make a little flat area here. Has like a widow's walk, which I'll put that in a bit. The widow's walk is the little railing that's on top of the roof. And you see those a lot with haunted houses. So for the windows in the house, we already have this nice, bright, warm color. So what I do is I actually take my little brush and I draw the windows in and paint all around the windows with black. So then you have the glow of the moonlight is your actual window light. So I'm going to take a little black. Oops, I almost dipped it in my wine. Yikes, that happens all the time to the students in the studio. I can't believe I did it. Okay, so what I'm going to do to make this a little more goth, I'm gonna put a little cross at the top here. Boom. Nice and wavy, bendy. Please try not to make it straight. And then windows, I like to play around. So like sometimes I'll do like a circular window, and these will all look really cool when the outside edge around it is painted black. And then I'll do like a cross through the window. Oh, let's do the widow's walk. So that is just going to be a little railing. It goes across here with some vertical lines that are not straight. Some are very bendy. Kind of looking a little more like a church, I guess. I'll do some arched windows here. Long and skinny. You can kind of design your own. Occasionally I'll mix a little water with my paint when I'm working with this little brush. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to fill in around these and see how they look and see what else I want to add in. Oh yeah, so this window is very, very, like, leaning, spooky. And then maybe I'll come down here a little bit, so these kind of look like they go together. And I'll do another nice, tall, skinny, arched window. The cool thing is, when the black dries, if you feel like, oh, if you thought, I really wish I had put a window right here, once the black is dry, you can mix this same color or even use just the plain yellow and make a whole nother window in there. It might take a couple coats, but you can do it. So on this one, here's what I'm going to do. This is very Tim Burton. I divide it vertically, and I'm just going to make some horizontal lines that are purposely not straight. Are you giving me refills? I need it tonight. So if you have room, you can do that on these too. It does make them look a little interesting. So what I'm doing is I'm floating my brush really lightly. It's hard to get a really thin line, but you can do it. Three hairs and some air. Actually, this is probably more like one hair and some air. And you could, you know, occasionally have one that maybe is blacked out, like a tooth missing, just to make it seem a little more run down. Okay, so let's see. Let's do some windows here. Here's what I'll do. I'll do like a typical Gothic pointed arch window right here. I guess this is a church. So the arch is pointed at the top, sort of, in theory. Painting around it. And then if you want, you could even do like a doorway with some windows on the side. Most of the windows I'll keep, they'll either be round or they'll be kind of long and skinny. And definitely a builder's nightmare. So now I'm going to fill black in around these guys, see how they look. We're not aiming for perfect architecture here. Like I said, builder's nightmare. Alright, those could use something interesting. There's not a lot of room. Here, I'll put a little bar across that one. And this one, maybe I'll do vertical. The door I'll probably leave alone. Maybe it's off its hinges.
You're off your hinges.
I am totally off my hinges. I am very tired tonight. Shut up. When is it your turn to teach on here, Paul?
You tell me.
Have you ever painted on a pumpkin?
No.
So these little windows at the top are, I guess, just little excess ways to leave light in or bring light in. All right, so I sort of have a haunted churchy house sort of thing. It's a building of some sort. It'll do the job. I like how it's tall and skinny. You could even add little extra outbuildings off to the side if you wanted to. I'm probably going to leave it, but I've got room over here to put some gravestones as well as here. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to put the spooky tree on next. Simple color palette here. So far we've only used yellow, white, and black. And I'm going to make a tree trunk. I always like to do a deciduous tree, and I make it kind of a weird Y shape at first. I do like to mix the water with the black paint for the fluidity. Not too much. You don't want it so it's going to drip off your pumpkin, although in some ways it might actually be kind of cool. So I'm going to do this sort of Y shape, and that is how I teach all my students to paint deciduous trees, because it's a really easy first way to learn these kind of trees. So, and then all of your branches, you want to keep them nice and long and kind of wavy. The wavier they are, the spookier it'll look, in my opinion. So I'm going to make some of these branches sort of reaching towards the house, and branch off of these other ones too. Split them all off, because that's how it's going to go in nature. I'm not pressing very hard at all. Very light pressure. Two hairs and some air. Maybe I'll put another one down here. I feel like the more long, creepy, skinny branches you add, the more haunted looking this tree is going to be, and the whole scene in general. These could even bend towards the house. Tree is sort of trying to grab whoever just walked in the house. Whatever spirits live there. It's the Whomping Willow. It's one of my favorite scenes in the Harry Potter movies. I actually did a Harry Potter painting on canvas shoes, like Tom's, for a friend's daughter for her birthday, which is in October. And the canvas shoes worked great. They were perfect. Perfect surface for it. And I did the Whomping Willow and Hedwig on one, and they were so cute. I got a picture sometime. I'll have to post it. That was about 5 years ago or so. So let's see. Looking pretty good. You decide when you're done with the branches. I feel like the more you add, the spookier it will look. There's just something about all these bare branches. Okay, that's probably pretty good. Now the gravestones are very easy. So you can do simple crosses. I like to make them lean, like maybe the ground has been penetrated with rainfall, or the tree roots have kind of come down and pushed all the graves up. And so yeah, wonky, tall, skinny things. Like this one could be just a cross, or I could do where I have like a cement block at the bottom. Definitely looks like a gravestone. And then of course there's the typical RIP ones that you see in Halloween stores. Maybe I'll do one over here. Leaning the other way. Rest in peace. And then on this particular one, I've done a similar painting before on a wood, little birch round circle thing for an ornament. I didn't have room on this side for gravestones, but I do now. You could also do another tree if you wanted to, but I'm going to just stick with the gravestones. You could do a wonky fence. When I was a kid, my parents almost bought a house that was right next to an old pioneer cemetery. I was totally not sure of that. I'm glad they didn't do it. I probably would have had lots of nightmares. Okay, so let's see here. That's looking good. Actually, I'm almost done with this, believe it or not. I do see some areas in the house where if I wanted to, I could add some more light windows once it's dry. I do have a lot of windows on there though, so I don't feel like it's 100% necessary. But I do want to add some bats. They're very simple. Little brush, black paint. And I just do sort of a little V. And the one thing you can do, this is a big bat. The one thing you can do is you can do a few little points, like scoops, for the bat wings hanging off there. Is that visible, Paul? Do I need to like lift it up? Yeah. So a little simple sharp Vs like this work. Maybe they're ravens, but most likely bats. And if you want to do like little points hanging off, just think of like the Batman symbol, what it looks like. Oh, hey, the dog is not happy. All right, so I'm going to let this one dry for a bit and then I'm going to do something kind of fun to it that's extra. We're going to go a little extra. So this looks pretty good. I like it. I'm going to set it aside, take a little sip. Hi, Suki. We have an old 13, almost 14-year-old dog here, and she's starting to get a little cognitive issues going on. So if you see her acting strange, that is why. Okay, I'm going to go back now to my owl, and I'm going to actually sketch the face on really quick. And I'm going to switch to my littlest brush. And I had mixed earlier the burnt sienna and the raw sienna. I came up with that color I called terracotta. It's a good color to use for sketching the face because it's kind of light and we use a little of it on the face anyway. And if you make a mistake, it can be blended in pretty easy. So their eyes are so cute. Let me bring my other painting over here. They're kind of shaped like, I've seen them where they're really round, and I've seen them where they're kind of lemon shaped, like this one. So you decide what's easiest for you. I think I'll just go with pretty simple round, and here's what I like to tell the students whenever we paint barn owl faces, which we do a lot in the studio, and that's on me. I love owls, especially barn owls. So I'm going to put a little dot to mark off. I'm going to do another one a little spaced away. So it looks really weird, tiny-eyed owl. And I'm gonna turn those into two little arch, like rainbow shapes. And just take your time and try and get them even-ish. Just get them close. They really want in tonight. Okay, and then I'm going to actually extend this down. I'm just sort of dabbing a little dot-to-dot thing. This is going to create the sides of their nasal area that turns into the beak. And I'm just sort of going to dot across the bottom here. You want to leave enough space for a little triangular beak. And I'll go ahead and paint that, really make it really thin and narrow. It's not a super wide like duck beak. Let's see, can we see that okay, Paul?
Yeah.
Yay! Okay, so it looks really weird. They do have this dark like inner eye thing. Kind of reminds me of what my old dog gets. That goes down from the inner corner of their eye slide down their nasal area, whatever that's called, and then their beak, right down to their beak. So I do put that on there. And then I want to draw the bottom part of the eye. So remember earlier we did a rainbow shape? You're going to do like a smile shape now. Just pretend you're mirror imaging the rainbow shape down below, or as close as possible as you can. Already it looks like some kind of weird, creepy owl. And here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to sort of brush this inner corner smudgy. It's actually their little feathers here. Kind of helps define their eyes, too. And if you need to darken up the outline of your beak, you can definitely do that. So, there we go. Now I'm going to paint the eye. Actually, I'm going to let it dry. I think if we paint the eyes black right now, it'll smear all together. But I do need another coat of the reddish brown around here. So that was your raw sienna and burnt sienna. Just get it close. It doesn't have to be exact because we're going to coat over the whole thing anyway. So it doesn't have to be the exact color. Just going to make my way around here. What this is doing is it's going to make it a lot more opaque. And you won't see so many streaky bits where you can see the pumpkin underneath. And if you have time and want to, you could give it a third coat if you feel like it's still too transparent. I think I'm going to be okay here. We do put some little freckly dots on the top of the head. That's the little black feathers they have up there. But with acrylic paint, you do have to let it dry for at least 5 minutes before you put a second coat on, because the second coat won't stick if the first coat is too wet. That is a mistake that you learn right away with acrylic painting. Why is it not covering up this hole? Again, painting on this three-dimensional surface with the little ridges it's a challenge in and of itself, but it's kind of fun. It's a fun challenge. And if you don't like your painting, just flip the pumpkin around and carve that up. Okay, so what I want to do now is, this part is probably dried a bit. I'm going to take my little brush and black paint. And they have the kind of beady black eyes, which I'll show you here. We put some really cool highlights in them, which make them look really neat. So let's go ahead and trace around your brownish outlines that we put on there to begin with. And fill it in solid. Gonna look like the zombie-eyed pumpkin owl for a bit. You could leave it like that if you want. It is the spooky time of year. It just ends up looking kind of hollow-eyed. Don't worry if you don't 100% get right to the edge of your original outline. Just get a black beady eye in there, you'll be good. So now I'm just going to check and see if they're similar in size. All right, looks pretty good. Gonna wash that brush off. You're looking pretty good, owl. You just kind of have a really weird flesh-colored face. Okay, so let's go ahead now and put some of the little black freckly parts on the top of the head. They go on the top of the head and kind of down the sides a bit. Let me pull up this painting to show you, so you can see them there. And yeah, they come down a little bit on the shoulders. And then what we'll do after that is we'll put the... Sorry, the dog is gagging a little bit. I don't know if you can hear it, but it's something he does a lot. Okay, so I'm going to do this dabby sort of feathery outline around the face after I do the freckles. Color-wise and brush-wise, let's use our number 8 brush, this middle one right here. And I am going to mix black and your burnt sienna together. So you get like a nice chestnutty brown, about like that. You'll know right away if it needs to be darker or if it needs more brown in it. And when you mix paint, you end up with a big glob on the brush. So I tend to like swipe some excess off on the palette or the towel. And here's what I'm gonna do. At the top of the head, I'll use the corner of the brush and just put these little freckly shapes, just little dots. I'm not using the handle end of the little brush like we did with the stars on the other one because I want these to be a little more ragged looking. Oh, we've got a bug. Hello, Mr. Bug. I don't want you to get painted on here, so I'm going to blow you away. I think he probably smells the wine. Okay, so I'm going to bring some of these little freckly splotches. They're not really dots, they're more like splotches. And with your paint, this brownish red being still a little bit wet, it actually blends really nicely. And I like it a lot. There, got one side done. Now I'll come down this side. Just like when we do the stars, you don't want them like evenly spaced apart. You want them to be sort of haphazard and unplanned. Kind of match it up. Looks like I need to add a little more here. My flesh colored face barn owl. Oops, I was washing the brush, but I don't actually need to. So I had a little oopsie here. That's fine because of what we do next. Same color, your black and brown mix. You might need to make a little more. So you're going to make that sort of chestnut deep brown that we did for the freckles. It doesn't have to be the exact shade. It could be a little lighter or darker. What we're going to do is I'm going to use just the edge of the brush, and I'm just going to dab around, putting real close together freckles to outline the face. So let me point that out on this other painting real quick. Stay. So you can see it here. And they do have that. For real in nature. It's like it's feathers, little short feathers that are dark, and they make this perfect, cute, adorable little outline around the face. And I always do it just by, I use the bottom side of the brush and dab around the edge. I feel like I could be a little darker with this. Yeah, about like that. Down around the chin. Doesn't have to be a perfect straight line. In fact, they don't have it that way, so make sure you're not falling into that very common thing that people do where you try to make a perfectly straight line. They're little feathers. I like to make it straight too sometimes, and I have to stop myself. So this is going to kind of clean up the point in the widow's peak. We don't have a whole lot left to do. We want to get this guy out of his flesh-colored phase. I'm going to probably paint the beak really quick. It could stay this sort of flesh color, but I think I'm going to make it kind of a pale yellow by mixing the white and yellow together. We'll see how that looks. Little brush. Because we've got a little area to fill in. I do like to leave some of the outlines, but if you had real heavy outlines, this is a good way to sort of fix it up and thin it out from the inside. There! You need some life to you. We'll get that going in just a minute. I want this edge to dry a bit before we start adding white feathers on the face, just because you can end up with a big smeary mess. It doesn't look so good. But one thing I want to do is they do have some shading around their eyes. I will bring my other painting over here real quick. It's light, and it just kind of is around their eye socket area. It's just different colored feathers. And it's probably a lot of times the light and shadow that we see. But I do like the depth that that gives it. You could leave it like this, but I will show you that extra step of some light shading. We don't want to go too crazy with it. Brush-wise, I'm going to use my 8. Again, my favorite. So I want to make this flesh color. You might have a little left dried on your palette that you can try and match up. And I'm going to just darken it a little bit with a little more black, probably. So to make this color, I'll remind you again, it was your burnt sienna, so the rust color brown. Your raw sienna, which is, some people, there's a similar color called yellow ochre. And quite a bit of white. Everything's drying. Usually what I'll do is I'll kind of hold my brush up and be like, oh yeah, that's not even close. Need a little more white. Dog is doing something. Okay.
It's real life, people. It's
real life in our house. In our little office that used to be a workout room that we never used. Okay, so now I want to darken this. I tried to mix a similar color to this. It doesn't have to be exact. I want to darken it a little bit by adding just a touch of black. And this is just for shading. So I'm going to paint a little on here so you can see. Yep, that's a good color for shading. But I have a lot on my brush just from mixing and globbing the paint all together. And I don't want to put a lot on the pumpkin because then I have to figure out where to push it out to. And suddenly you've got the whole face shaded in. So I'm going to wipe off a lot of that paint on my palette or your towel, either way. And I'm just going to come under the eye. I'm working outward. You can come down the side a little. Working outward. Here I'll turn it and I'll use the skinny edge of the brush. Then you get these really cool feathery brush strokes. If you feel more comfortable, use the small brush, but this one seems to work just fine. So I'm going to go all the way around to the inner corner. It's almost like we're making a burst of, it's almost like a sunshine where we have the circle and then the rays going out from it. Bring that shading real close to the black. So that looks pretty good. You can see that okay, Paul? My contact lenses are starting to dry out. We'll be done soon. Shut up. Okay, so now I'm going to go down and do this one. Working my way outward.
You need to move the pumpkin this way.
This way?
No, towards me.
There you go. Okay. I apologize if I keep moving it out of frame. Again, this is our second video, so we're learning all the tricks. By the time we do our 500th video, it will be perfect. So just doing that little sort of sunburst thing out from the eye. If you overlap into the black eye a bit, which I definitely did, don't worry about it. It's easy to clean up with a little black. Or maybe it just has a cataract. The other thing I want to do with this shading is they have a ridge that goes right down the middle of their nasal area. And I shade that in and then I paint the white feathers kind of in and around it, which helps diminish it a little bit because at first it's going to look like a harsh line. But on their face, let's set him here, they're feathers down their front nasal area, whatever that's called, they grow like this together. And that's what that, the dog bumped it. That's what that line is sort of indicating. So that helps us get that look. So I'm going to take, before my paint dries, and kind of just down from the widow's peak, just dot in a line and you're just sort of dividing the nose in half with just a little shading. Don't be alarmed if it looks crazy and out of place right now, because the white feathers and whatnot are gonna clean that up. And that's all we have to do next are white feathers and some highlights in the eyes. But I do want to set this aside for a minute, and just a couple minutes to, you sat there. I'm gonna go back to the haunted house, and I promised I would show you a really fun little thing that I love to do in the studio and at home, depending on what I'm making. I'm a big fan of glitter. I think I mentioned it earlier. And I managed to find, and I think you can find it at Michael's, but I actually ordered it online at a craft store, this really finely milled black glitter, which is so cool in here. Let me grab it. Okay, so this is it. It looks like it's from Doris. And it's super duper fine and so awesome. And then I have matte Mod Podge. I used to buy the glossy kind, and then I found that the matte actually is a little more invisible. So that's what I'm going to use. And I'm just going to squirt a little on my palette. Try not to mistake it with white paint. Make sure your brush is clean. Make sure you grab a sip. Okay, so you could put glitter anywhere. You could do the whole ground. You could do the gravestones. You could do the tree. It's a lot of work to do all those little things because you're painting Mod Podge over and you have to do little portions at a time and then put the glitter on so it doesn't dry. So I'm probably just going to do the house and just the top edge of the land. So here's what I'm doing. Just going to paint some Mod Podge on the house. Working kind of quickly. Doesn't have to be 100% perfect because this does dry clear. Now this is something that the rain will definitely wash this away. So if you want to keep a glittery pumpkin, you might keep it in your house. You could try the front porch if it's under an overhang, but I would worry that if you are here in Oregon or a wet state, the condensation might actually just make it all slide off. You can re-glitter it though. So Mod Podge is drying a little. I'm gonna freshen that up to work kind of fast. Okay, so now I'm gonna take my awesome glitter. And normally I would put like some kind of tray underneath to catch it, because I like to, glitter to me is like, don't waste it. So I do like to make sure that I have it and can save it. So it looks like I just destroyed my haunted house, but you'll see in a minute, it will look super cool. So maybe I'll just get a little Mod Podge here. Maybe on the top edge of the land that's sort of facing the moon. Feel free to get a gravestone here and there if you can manage to brush it on there. Okay, now more glitter. This is nice. It has little shaker holes. It's kind of like your salt shaker. I love this black glitter. We use it at Halloween for all kinds of things, but it does make a little bit of a mess.
You know what this painting needs?
Glitter!
More glitter.
More glitter! Okay, now we get to shake it off. Shake it off! Shake it off!
You can't do that. Taylor Swift will sue us.
Okay, so it did get little black specks out here on the moon. They're not connected. There's no Mod Podge under them, so they're not going to stick. What I would do, if you have that, which you will, let the Mod Podge dry for at least 20 minutes. Then take your big brush, and I dry it off really good, or if you have a dry brush, even better. And just go through and brush that excess glitter off, and you'll be good to go. But look at that! Is it sparkling, Paul? Can you see it?
No.
Well, it looks really cool. I'm going to...
Oh, there it now it is.
Yay! So you can glitter the whole entire pumpkin if you want. One thing that would look really cool, too, you could paint the stem black, let it dry, paint the stem with Mod Podge, and then cover it with glitter, the black glitter too, and that's super cool. Another fine milled glitter you could use for this is purple. So we're officially done with this guy, and I'll let it dry and brush that excess glitter off. Yay, I've got one front porch pumpkin den, well, inside the house pumpkin den. And now I'm gonna finish the owl, which is just a few steps. So I'm gonna clean off my number 8 brush. For the feathers, I like to get the thin little lines, so I'm gonna use the skinny edge of the brush for most of the feather work I do. Ah, I need to get some more white. Actually, no, I'll just borrow from here. Hey, Paul, I'm gonna actually have you grab me some white paint. I think it's in the cabinet right there. I'm gonna need it in a minute. Some of this got polluted. Okay, so let's start with the nose. So I'm gonna start right at the inside of the eyes, and I'm just gonna work my way towards that line we painted in last. And as I go down this nose area, they're gonna start going down. And then finally at the bottom, it'll just be a little fuzz along the bottom edge of the nose. So I'm overlapping, thank you, Paul. I'm overlapping my line just a little bit. I do want it to show, but you don't need it to show as harshly as it was when you first painted it on. And let's get the other side. So I start at the inner corner of the eye, working my way towards that line. Don't worry if you overlap some of your inner eye dark brown goop, whatever it is. I'm sure it's feathers. My brush has a lot of paint on it, so I'm gonna just swipe it off so I have a nice skinny edge again. And go ahead and make nice little feathers dangling over the beak just a bit. And now I'm gonna work my way up. So what you have is that look with the feathers coming together like this. And you can still see bits of your flesh color base coat coming through, and that's gonna provide some really nice natural shading. So don't do such a heavy, like, solid area. You can do thick paint, but just concentrate, like maybe one or two feathers has really thick paint, and then you leave a little bit of the undercoat here and there, just for the depth. So now I'm gonna take, and I'm gonna work my way above the eye here. Go ahead and flick some over the outline of the face. These are little fuzzy feathers, kind of like the little down feathers that little chicks have. Working up and away from the eye, and as I come around the outside edge of the eye, I'm working away from it. All right, I could bring that white in a little more. So the feathers on the cheeks here are gonna grow sort of outward and then down here. Outward and down. Around here, if it starts feeling too solid, you can wipe some white paint off and then just gradually sort of smudge it inward, so you have just a little ghost layer of paint that you can really easily fade in there. And let's go around the beak here and under it. Little chin fuzzies. And you can work your way up like this, or if it's easier for you, because we started up here and worked our way down, if it's easier for you to do that exact same thing, go ahead and do it. That's probably what I'll do. Won't be too long now. I'll be done with this moving, rolling canvas. So I'm coming down here on the cheeks. And my feathery brush strokes are going down and outward. Always using the skinny edge of the brush. That's what gives you these nice pointy edges. It's just kind of a little flick. Not pushing very hard either. And again, around the eye, I want to wipe off excess paint so I have like nothing on my brush. And I'll just work some of that wet paint inward just a bit. Wiping off more off your brush if needed. So it's not such a harsh edge. Let's take a look. Not too bad. Some of the things I've done in other owl paintings is I've taken a completely different color, like this Bahama Blue, which we love. And you can do some sort of expressionist color by streaking some of that in there. It looks really cool. Certain colors I wouldn't recommend, like red. Unless you're going for the Halloween bloody owl look. Poor thing. Okay, so decide for yourself if you feel like you need to go back and add another coat of paint with the white, but we're almost done. I'm going to do the chest feathers, and then we'll do a little highlight in the eyes and the beak, and we will be done with this guy. So let's go on the chest feathers. They're kind of longer, and they grow downward from the chin downward. We want to cover up all of that flesh color that we started with. Now this flesh color, other times I've painted barn owls, I've had raw umber, which is a very gray brown. And I've used that as an undercoat too. So this is probably just a little more of a warmer undercoat. You could paint little black peppery freckles on the chest too, if you want. But in this version, I'm gonna leave it. See how it's looking? Pretty good. Okay, so now I'm gonna wash this brush. Everything from here on out will be the small brush. Let me pull my picture over here again. So I like to do a little dot in the inner corner of the eye. And then down here, a little white swoop. It's almost like white eyeliner. And what it is on us, we have the pink. It's called a waterline. That's what we are painting on. And that's really going to make the eye like really round and kind of glassy-like. So you want very, very little paint on the very tip of the bristles of the little brush. So what I'm going to do first in each eye is I'm going to do a little white shine in the upper inner corner. You can just sort of dab the brush around. I don't like to do a perfect circle too much. And now this is where you're going to be a little careful. You can always paint black over it and redo it. But I'm just going to go from the outer corner, working my way in. This little thin white line. And now here I laid my palm on the pumpkin. That happens sometimes. I'll just go back and touch that up later. So this one now too, inner corner, working my way. Very light. This is like half a hair and some air. And I could have even used less paint. I've got relatively large eyes, so I might actually do another little tiny shine halfway between the two. Big anime eyes. And then on the beak, I'll usually just do a white shine down one side so that makes it look a little pearly. Depending on what color your beak was, it may or may not show. But I've got some spots to touch up where my palm rubbed against it. That's very typical and can be done anytime. The other thing you can do with this, which I won't show since I showed it on the last painting, you would let this black in the eyes dry. Very carefully come in with some Mod Podge and paint just the black area. You want to leave the white shines. And then sprinkle your black glitter in the eyes, and it looks really, really cool. So let's have a look at our two completed projects. They stay put. There we go. Front porch is ready in time for the big holiday, and these won't rot, and they're good fun. Kids love them when they come to the door. They're always really excited to see them. So I hope you enjoyed this and you learned a little bit and maybe you'll follow along. But if not, it's always kind of fun to just learn some new techniques. So we will be doing our live video tomorrow on Tokatee Falls, which is a landscape painting for a place in Oregon. So we will see you tomorrow. Sayonara.